Psychology is all around us. Psychological elements can be seen throughout the lifespan, from birth until death. Films are a wonderful tool to explain psychological theory and occurrences in our lives. Characters interact within each frame of film psychological concepts. The films we remember most and view multiple times engage us by capturing the presence of these psychological dynamics in an authentic way. I invite you to join me, Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, licensed clinical psychologist and film consultant, and my guest today, Asia Simone, of the film Happy Hour, to discuss the best psychology in film. Today, we are fortunate to have Miss Asia Simone. Asia, how are you doing?
I'm doing so good. I'm excited to be here.
Well, I'm so glad to have you. It was such a great opportunity to meet you at the Academy Museum while in LA. And right now you're in LA currently, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Well, one of the things that, you know, I think is so great about your film Happy Hour is that it features not just you, your music, but also your community as well. But let's start first with you. Tell us a little bit about what you do.
Well, I'm a singer-songwriter with also a musical theater background. Also trying to get into voiceover acting, working on a few scripts. It's off and on with those, but mainly singing and writing. I've been playing the ukulele for about, oh my gosh, I want to say maybe 8-9 years now. But yeah, Happy Hour was my first big project. I did it during the pandemic, since we all had so much time on our hands, but it's a very special project to me. Yeah, and hopefully I get to work on some other cool things this year or in the future.
Well, Happy Hour is such a unique film, honestly, because it gets to feature you in a character, but it also gets to feature numerous songs that you have created, and it follows a storyline as well. Tell me about the inspiration of this film. What had you craft this?
So I honestly, when I did the album, I don't think I went into it thinking like, we're going to do something as big as that. I truly thought like, hopefully we get to do a music video. But I really wanted to just kind of show people what goes on in my brain. And a lot of it is very much inspired by like cartoons, and we pulled a lot from like Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, Sesame Street, that kind of style of like talking to the camera and breaking the fourth wall. And the whole thing is improvised. We don't have a script or anything. So story-wise, we were really just like playing around. It was so fun to film, and we did it all in the living room in here in our apartment. But it was so interesting to work on it. I think the more we thought about Mr. Misery, the story just kind of flowed. And Mr. Misery came about actually a long time before I even worked on Happy Hour. It was a song I did, and I don't think I ever put it out, but it's called Mr. Misery and the Lonely Girl. And that was the first time I even thought of him. And then back to in 2020, when I was working on the album, I was like, I want to bring him back, because I thought it was so interesting to kind of have this character representing like my anxiety, my depression. And I was like, it'd be cool to explore that. And I talked to Ryan a bit more. We were brainstorming for probably a couple months on the video itself. And I'm really happy with how it turned out. I think it's so weird. And in my words, it's very spoopy and very, very me.
Ryan DeForeest, director, producer. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Good friend. Okay. Well, why don't we take a little look at the clip of Mr. Misery, and we'll be right back.
Ladies, babies, and gentle babies, coming to you live from the subconscious of her mind, the spoopiest, doobiest, loopiest girl in the world, Asia Simone!
Simone, and this is Happy Hour.
Now won't you listen, honey, while I say, how could you tell me that you're going away? Don't say that we must part. Don't break my aching heart. You know I loved you true for many years. Loved you night and day. Oh, honey, baby, can't you see my tears? Listen while I say. After you've gone and left me crying, after you've gone, there's no denying you'll feel blue, you'll feel sad, you'll miss the bestest pal you ever had.
Mr. Misery is fantastic. You said you had created him a long time ago. What about him was intriguing to you?
When I first thought about him, I always kind of picture him as, like, I don't know if you're familiar with the film The Babadook. Like, that was a very heavy inspiration of him, but trying to give him a bit more, like, pizzazz, make it very, you know, like cartoony, musical theater-ish, like pulling from Cabaret with the MC. And I just wanted some sort of physical representation of this kind of darker feelings inside of me. And that's who I pictured. And the song I originally wrote about him, it was kind of like him coming after me and no one else being able to pull me from that. And so I was like, I want to play around with this a bit more. And I love horror movies, spooky, ooky things. And so it was fun to kind of play with that as well and make essentially this little horror character in my universe.
You know, I have to say, Mr. Misery psychologically is so fascinating to me. He's, first of all, so well done in many ways, not just by the way he's created and makeup and how he presents. And like you said, his musical theatrical talents are just really astounding. But also psychologically, he's interesting because he's a companion that follows someone along the way, that Misery is adopted into someone's life. I mean, he's found on a playground, right? Mm-hmm. He isn't necessarily just a part of a person necessarily. It's something that's found, adopted, and then is kind of with an individual in a reliable way. And sometimes at moments that are very inconvenient, coupled with the impact that he has, is pretty aggressive and violent in many ways. And so does, let's say, this character in Happy Hour recover from Mr. Misery?
I want to say yes, but I don't think so. And that's only because the songs I've been working on lately, my mind still feels like he's there. He's just kind of, he'll always be there. And I think there is a point where he finally just kind of takes over the character of Asia. But I think he's still there in the end, I feel like.
And that is also, I think, the beauty of this film is that Misery is still there, honestly, because generally humans do feel miserable at times. It's a normal way of feeling and it comes and goes or can come and go, but it will always generally be within us, at just like happiness will always be within us and sadness is always generally within us as well. It's integrated and it's not always present, but it is still always there. And that's one of the things that I really liked about happy hour, is that it didn't give this end result that seemed unrealistic, is that Mr. Misery is there. Now what to do with it? Now for you, you mentioned that Asia is like, is still overcome by it within happy hour. But I guess the quest would be for most individuals is how to be able to integrate Mr. Misery, so he's maybe smaller, the way that he was found on the playground as being super tiny rather than huge and lifelike.
Mm-hmm. I, with the things I've been working on lately, I've been trying to figure out what it is that would make him back to that size or make it more like it's easier to get through the day and it's not something that's gonna kind of destroy me. It's like manageable. And it's so, I feel like it's very cheesy, but I think it has a lot to do with just like loving yourself. And that's what I'm kind of trying to find in these new songs. But I've never been the one to write anything happy. It's still always kind of very sad. But like this song, After All, that I just did for a video, it's kind of this idea of trying to find love in other people and maybe you'll feel better about yourself. And that's just not how anything works. And so I feel like there's this weird relationship with Mr. Misery where he's trying to hold on to Asia while she's trying to, you know, find these, essentially these cures to get rid of him, to make it smaller, to make this pain go away, and it's not. And so he's just kind of taking over her more and more.
Yeah, again, I do think that the way that Mr. Misery is enacted within this film is really helpful for people to be able to hopefully align with Asia within this film, that individuals can overcome misery, but many times do not. And the damage that Mr. Misery can cause along the way is really visible. And it doesn't necessarily make for a quote unquote happy hour, despite how people present.
Mm-hmm.
You know, happy hour also involves the community. You are on the streets in Hollywood interviewing people. Tell me about this.
Can I tell you, I have my anxiety that day. I'm not the person that goes up to people. I won't. So, and you can ask anyone. I'm terrible at like, hi, I'm Asia. How's it going? Like, I was so stressed that day, but surprisingly, everyone was really nice. I honestly thought, because it's Hollywood, so, you know, you're going to get like Spider-Man over here fighting Freddy Krueger and then like someone who's just, they're off the walls. I don't know. But everyone was surprisingly so nice that day. And no one gave us any sort of bad attitude or were weirded out at all by us just on the street putting a microphone to their face. And a lot of the things they were saying, I was like, oh, this is so nice. And I mean, there was that one moment where we truly almost got banned from the mall.
Yes.
That little moment, I was like, wow, we're really doing this. We're really putting it all on the line for art. But it was so fun that day. And it honestly took me out of my comfort zone to talk to people like that. But it was such a simple question. And I think people really had beautiful answers for them, whether it was just, I want world peace, or, you know, I want to be a doctor. I want to do this. I came to California to do this. Like, I don't know. It was just really refreshing, because that is not at all what I thought we were going to get that day.
What did you anticipate?
You know, I very much went in thinking we're going to get, you know, not so serious answers, people that just kind of, they see a camera and they're like, oh, it's one of those YouTubers. Like, I just want to be silly and I want to go viral. That's pretty much what I thought going in, was just, we were going to get very not serious answers, off the wall or kicked out somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, the answers that you got were very meaningful and heartfelt. I mean, some people were sharing really what is their dream regarding like career-wise, wanting to be a fireman or wanting to be a nurse, or But a lot of people really shared wanting to help people and these very altruistic ideas that people desire for themselves. And of course, you get a lot of answers of money.
Yes.
Same, right? And I, you know, some people would say, well, that's Hollywood. And I think that's a representation of, you know, America. Many people want money. People want fame. But there are some people that you interviewed that when you got a little deeper with them, sometimes the money was to take care of their family or to do something with it. So it wasn't just about having the money. It was also about doing something potentially positive with it. And you said people were really nice. I'm wondering, you know, some people would even say, might that have been because it was COVID time, because people were isolated? But it seems like a lot of people were on the street that day.
There were a lot. It was hot. There were a lot of people. But yeah, we picked probably the busiest time to be out there. And there were some people who we didn't even have to walk up to them and ask. They just kind of stopped. And they were like, what are you doing? We're filming a video. What for? And they were just down to do it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, one of the things that luckily Happy Hour gets to see and, you know, is actually document a little bit about the pandemic. I mean, everyone that you are interviewing generally has on a mask outside even. And so it really gives us a snapshot as to what time this is as well, when Happy Hour is created. And so that is a unique feature in your film as well. Well, before we continue, why don't we take a break and we'll be right back with Asia Simone.
I do love what I do for a living. I never dreamed that having this career was possible until I came to UDC. I met a professor when I decided to finish up my degree program. She told me, hey, why don't you go and intern on Capitol Hill? The internship led to being a staffer. I would have never been opened up to that opportunity if that professor would have never urged me and said, you know, I see something in you. My UDC experience changed my life. UDC helped me find my possible.
Find your possible. Visit udc.edu/possible to learn more.
Asia, we have had the lovely opportunity to interview you regarding your film Happy Hour that features you as a creative individual, an actor, as well as a wonderful ukulele player and singer and songwriter. And we've talked a little bit about how this film was inspired, but you also have shared that we actually have the luxury of having your director and producer available to ask him questions as well. Mr. Ryan DeForeest, correct?
Hey, what's going on?
Oh, wow.
That's one of the puppets.
As for the audience watching this, when you see Happy Hour, this will all make sense where this puppet is. These puppets, love it.
Yeah.
Welcome, all three of you.
Four of us.
Ryan, how do you know Asia and how did the two of you connect?
So I know Asia through a mutual friend who's also one of our roommates. I think the first time I met Asia, I thought she was so interesting. I just thought like everything about her just, there was an essence about her that I just gravitated towards. And then I learned she made music. And then once we started living together, we really started to kind of formulate the idea for this film. And yeah, and it was a great process. We're both very collaborative with each other, and we also can tell each other the truth of like, oh, this idea doesn't work, or this, you know, this feels strange, or like, you know, we're very open and in talking about how we feel about things. And so yeah, it's been a great journey. I've loved knowing this one for a while. So how long has it been? It's been like...
Has it almost been...
I've known you since 2016? 15,
yes.
15, maybe?
2016, 2015.
Yeah, so a good 8 or 9 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. So I'm sure the two of you do know how to collaborate well with each other and communicate what's in your mind to make it actually come out within the film.
Yeah, I mean... Before Happy Hour, we did a lot of just like smaller videos of like just her performing songs, her, you know, applying for like competitions, singing competitions. And so that kind of got our gears turning in terms of how we wanted to go about making Happy Hour, which I don't think either of us expected to make like 30 minutes of Happy Hour, but yeah, it was such a beautiful way of getting into that.
Asia indicated that really Happy Hour is a way to give the audience a view into her mind, which, you know, is extraordinarily vulnerable as a creative to do. And yet, Asia, you indicated that going up to people and saying, "Hi, my name's Asia," was anxiety provoking, yet you allow everyone into your mind through Happy Hour. How is that made more comfortable for you?
I honestly cannot explain. I don't know why I've always been very anxious. Even when you came up, or when I was talking to you in the museum, like doing stuff like that, for some reason it gives me anxiety to approach people. But I don't know why, whatever, it's like a camera's on me, I'm fine.
She's an actress. Actress through and through.
I like attention.
Yeah.
I like attention, but only to a certain point.
Right.
Otherwise, I'm kind of shy. I'm kind of quiet. I think there's always going to be that little bit of me that's like, ooh. But I just think Happy Hour, I was able to just really be silly, be goofy.
Yeah.
But, you know, walking up to people on the street, it was different because I also didn't know how people were going to react to that. Right. So it was like, hopefully you're not gonna get mad or be weird.
Now, after knowing Ryan for this long, does he bring out some of that confidence in your ability to be able to do this work?
Yes.
And it's crazy because, like, you know, Happy Hour was, I think it was big for both of us, but it was also a way for both of us to kind of get out of our comfort zone. And I'm like, in my personal and my professional life, I'm a pusher. Like, I always try to push people to be the best that they can be. And so I did kind of push Asia to do a lot of things that felt weird to her or felt out of character for her. But again, like she said, once she's in front of a camera, like it turns on. She's an actress through and through. and yeah, it was beautiful. And whose idea was it to do the street on Hollywood? Was it me?
I think it was you, because we were like, we should do a Billy on the street.
Oh, we were watching Billy Eichner. Yes. And we were like, oh, let's kind of do this. But for us, you know, because we don't, you know, Billy, you know, it's great that we can see like a gay man on street kind of interviewing people with this crass kind of humor and personality. But I think it elevates it when you put a Black woman in the center of that, and you give her the chance to shine. And she did an amazing job, even though she felt so anxious about it. I felt anxious about it, but I can only imagine what it was like putting the microphone in front of people. But some people, like that little girl, came up to us while we were filming.
Yeah.
And she was like, "Hey, what are you doing? I want to be a part of this." You know, there's just that thing of people wanting that attention. And like you said, about the time of COVID, it was like people were locked in. So they wanted to come out of that and you know, just express themselves more.
Asia, you know, with expressing themselves more, this provided you a wonderful platform to do that. And again, be able to share these vulnerable aspects of who you are, not just like Mr. Misery, but also the puppets. We can talk about them since they've now been, you know, introduced to us, right? Thank you. You know, they kind of work like what we would consider, Freud would say, they're kind of like your super ego. They're kind of like, well, what if this happens? This bad thing may happen, and kind of the worrying thing of being able to then perform to your best ability. When you created the puppets, I'm not sure, when I say you, I mean either one of you within this process, how did you imagine their presence to be within the film?
I think we both kind of knew that they were going to be the voices in my head that are a bit negative. They're always like, well, think about this, because that's just how my brain works anyway. Going into any situation is always thinking of the negative outcome of things. And we knew that right away.
Yeah. It was so interesting because, you know, like, we were like, hey, yeah, let's have puppets, let's have dolls, let's have like as many like kind of childlike, but also strange and like eerie kind of things to be in the film. And so when we were kind of looking around for things, we saw these two puppets and like I fell in love, and Asia was like, okay. but yeah, they added personality to the anxieties and the depression, because, you know, anxiety is not something that's like just one singular voice that's in your head. It's like multiple things, multiple feelings and emotions that you have. So to give those anxieties life through these puppets and these dolls was something we were kind of aiming for.
You know, this show, I always feel like once we get into the flow of things is never like long enough. We are actually out of time, if you can imagine. But I wanted to thank you both for coming on to the show and being available. Ryan DeForeest, thank you for your creation and working with Asia, directing and producing, editing this film, and doing all of the work that you did. It's beautifully, beautifully done.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And Asia, thank you so much. I'm so happy that I met you on travel, researching for a new book. And hopefully we will be able to stay in connection and in touch as well.
Yeah.
We are so lucky to actually have not just you, but also the presence of your ukulele available to be able to provide us a song to sign off. However, before we do so, how can people watch Happy Hour? How can they get in contact with the both of you?
So if you want to watch Happy Hour, it is on YouTube. It'll be on my page, Asia Simone. If you want to get in contact with me, the easiest way is going to be Instagram @its_Asia_Simone. You can listen to the album on Spotify, Apple Music, Amazon, Tidal, like any music streaming platform.
Yeah. And then for me, Ryan DeForeest, my Instagram is @DeForeest. It's spelled a little strange, DeForeest. And then also this project was made for our art collective, the Box Collective, which is a great organization that supports Black, BIPOC, and queer and trans artists. So if you want to check that out, that'd be amazing. That's Boxed Collective, BXD Collective. And yeah.
Thank you again so much. Don't leave. We're about to hear Asia Simone's song as well. Thank you again for joining us. If you want to get in contact with me, follow me on Instagram @PsychMindedMedia. We'll see you next time. After all.
It's hard to see the red when the world is rose colored. It's hard to say goodbye when all you have is each other.